you speak to that? You know, what was your initial? Mm-hmm. Obviously, you heard the voice of God.
Yes.
That's, you know, that's most importance. What due diligence? Was there any due diligence? Did you hit the ground running, man? Were you a novice? Were you in rebellion? You know, because there are churches that was birthed out of rebellion.
Right.
Were you angry?
Right.
Is your church? All right, so that makes your membership angry.
Right.
What did you do
right
to establish the ministry and cause success at this point?
Success, what started with me is that God told me, you know, and I'm a PK.
Yeah.
I'm a pastor's kid. Shouts out to my dad, Apostle Linnell D. Caldwell,
yes,
world changers
sir
in the building. Y'all know
yeah,
that.
Yeah,
right
yeah
now, 8 Mile, those
are
my people.
Now
yeah,
that's
a plug. He preaching right now, you know, so it is what it is. But, you know, I was a PK, and it was hard. It was hard for me to leave my dad's church.
Mm.
You know, I'm hearing God telling me to do something, but it's like the blueprint is the son always take the, you know, the reins of the church and things of that nature.
Right.
But God took me to a scripture, and it was just like, just mesmerized me to my mind when he told Abram, he said, you got to get away from your family, from your father's house, and from your kindred.
Wow.
And he had him to get away because what he was getting ready to do in him was different.
Mm-hmm.
You know, my background is traditional Baptist.
Yeah.
You know, my father, he stepped away from the traditional Baptist.
Yeah, yeah.
He didn't got away. I don't know how to hoop. I wish I could hoop. You know, hooping preachers tear the church up. You know what I'm saying? Preachers like us, we going line upon line, precept on precept. And they looking at us like, come on, Rev, what else you got?
You got?
You know what I'm saying? You know, so that was difficult in itself just to leave.
Mm.
And I left a church that, you know, 1,000-seat sanctuary, screens, bookstores, and classrooms, and all this stuff, for me to go into the basement of Northwest Activity Center.
Wow. Wow.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
I found myself in the basement. I didn't know how to start a church.
Yeah.
You know, I took a couple of dollars that I had, rented some time at the Northwest Activity Center. You know, I didn't even know how to buy offering baskets. I went to an offering arts and crafts store and bought some stuff you put plants in.
Yeah,
it was gold and they shine.
Right,
so I'm saying, we'll make it work. You know,
make it work,
we do what we got to do. So I made it work, you know. But the whole process, you know, people were coming. You know, the word got out. You know, I didn't pass out any flyers to start off.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because I'm like, I'm not doing it.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? I'm not going to do any flyers because I don't want it to look like I'm in rebellion and nothing like that.
Yeah.
If people find out, they find out.
Yeah.
Which people start hearing the word about it.
Mm-hmm.
And so with that process, you know, I noticed how I'm over at the Northwest Activity Center and a lot of the people that was coming to the church were Eastsiders.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, wow. The east side biting.
Yeah.
So if the east side biting, driving to the west side, I wonder what would happen if we had a location on the east side.
Mm-hmm.
Praise God, one of the members had a building they wasn't using. We went in there. It was a beauty salon. We changed into a church.
Wow.
You know?
Wow.
And then we kind of packed that out to the point where I remember a couple of times I almost tripped over some kids while I was preaching because we were so jammed tight, you know, in there. And so God led us to, you know, make a move on a building. You know, and I went on the websites looking for buildings and things of that nature. And the story behind that is, you know, our ministry was only like a year and a half, 2 years old. And no bank wanted to touch us.
For a building.
Yeah, they didn't want to touch us.
Yeah.
They said, okay, you got money saved up, but you're too young.
Mm-hmm.
Too young. And praise God, you know, God raised up a man of God that found favor with me. And he said he wanted to sell the building to me. You know, I saw the building I liked. I went in there trying to act calm, cool, and collective. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
not
yeah
too excited. And he said he wanted to sell the building to us. But we ain't had no money for it.
Right.
You know, because all the banks turned us down. But then God raised up somebody that was a blessing to our ministry and helped us finance our first building, which is on Whittier. That was our first building. Actually, two buildings came with that. And as of about a month ago, we purchased two other buildings right next door to it for our youth facility and community facility.
Yeah.
So what I would say to people is, if you heard from God, nothing else matters.
Amen.
Because we're people that walk by faith and not by sight.
But you're married.
But I'm married.
You said nothing else matters.
Well, we ain't going to go down that road because when it's all said and done, God told Lot, I'm going to bring you out. Don't look back.
And
if you notice, Lot's wife looked back and Lot didn't even check to see if she was all right. He like, look, I know what God said. You can die if you want.
Come on. And I mean
you specifically.
You know, generally speaking, you know, because people get that, you know.
Yeah.
I heard God, bottom line. Oh, you're a bully. You're not hearing God. Mm-hmm. You know, God can speak through me to you.
Mm-hmm.
But I heard God.
Yeah.
And if it's anti of what God told me, then you may have to pipe down for a season.
Right.
You know.
Right.
So I can hear clear. So I know that I'm hearing God. Now, if I fumble, if I mess up, then we'll come back and say, okay. But then that was maybe I did miss God type deal. So you said you gotta hear the voice of God.
Well, see, it's two things. I want to address on that when you say about hearing from God. One, God will confirm it with his written word.
Come on.
See, I heard God tell me to leave. You see what I'm saying? Yeah, I heard him say to leave, but then he backed it up
in his word
and showed me in scripture where Abram left. And then he took me over into Mark when he said, none have left father.
Yeah.
Mother, brothers, sisters, lands that haven't gotten it back with 100-fold.
Yes, Lord.
So
yes,
right
Lord.
Now I'm in a season where I done got everything back. You know what I'm saying? My church is like the baby church, the First Baptist World Changers.
Oh, wow.
We connected. It's a unified front. You know what I'm saying? They holding down the west side. I'm holding down the east side and Mount Clemens.
Yeah.
You know? So God put everything back in place.
Yeah.
And I remember my dad came to me, man. It was one of the most beautiful things I've heard my father say to me. He said this. He said, you have the ability to go where I can't go now. You know, just to hear your dad, you know what I'm saying, your biological dad and your spiritual father, you know what I'm saying, endorsing what you're doing.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Because we kind of two different types of preachers, even though we preach the same word.
Yeah.
You know my dad. My dad, you know how he is. He hands on in the minute.
Yeah.
He do it himself. Yeah. You know, I'm a little bit more of training folks to do it for you.
Sure, sure.
Praise God. Yeah. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Training to keep this train moving. There you go.
Right.
You ain't gonna kill me. Praise God.
Come on.
You know, and then I'm reminded when you talked about if you miss God.
Mm.
Peter was in a boat.
Yeah.
And Peter said, Lord, if it be thou.
Come on.
Being me to come out there on the water.
Come on.
And Jesus said, come on with your bad self. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah,
so
yeah.
He steps out the boat. And to us, it looked like Peter failed because the Bible says he started looking at his situation and started sinking.
Mm.
Well, it was a miracle that was happening in the midst of him sinking. Notice, he was walking on water. If he took his eyes off Jesus, he should have just dropped in. But in the midst of that, God was still holding him up, even though he took his eyes off Jesus.
Yeah.
And the text says, beginning to sink. So
beginning
when he saw the water hitting that ankle and hitting that calf and hitting that knee, he knew he better do something.
Come
Lord,
on.
Save me.
Amen.
Wow.
And a lot of times when you're missing it, if we got enough sense in the midst of missing it, Lord,
save me.
Have mercy on me.
Yeah.
And somebody said, if he did it before, he'd
do it
again. This ain't the first time you've been in trouble.
Glory to God.
And see, I'm going to tell you this. One of the things I told people when I was starting out my ministry, I said, I would rather step out on faith thinking that I heard God than to stay in the boat not knowing if I heard from it.
Amen.
I believe I'm going to step out because if I missed it,
glory to God.
If I missed it, now watch this. Now that's only a lesson learned for the next time. Now I know where I missed it. And there are times where God will allow you to go through things to build your faith. See, a lot of times we want things that we name and claim, and God is saying, your faith ain't there.
Terry.
And he'll allow you to go through some stuff to build your faith for this.
Oh, I know you're right, man.
You know what I'm saying? You want the faith for the nations, but you have faith for your community first.
Come on.
You know what I'm saying? Can you deal with that? Can you deal with your city before it's time to go to Zimbabwe and Yugoslavia? Can you handle Pookie and Ray Ray? Because when Jesus told the disciples to go, he said, start in Jerusalem. Meaning you start at home first.
Amen.
You always start at home. And a lot of times we take this ministry thing and make it too big when we can't even do it.
Wow. Amen.
Well, we just got to start at home first.
Start at home first.
That's how Jesus did with the disciples.
Wow, Terry.
So I just went to the community center and the rest is history, man.
Wow.
Praise God.
That's awesome.
Praise God,
man. That's awesome.
That's
a good place to just worship God right there. Because that was a word, man. That was a word.
Was.
People are missing the big picture.
Yeah.
You said in the midst of him sinking, a miracle was yet taking place.
It was still taking place.
Come on, God was still
He was still holding him up. And a lot of us,
when
I know we can get a witness.
God was still right there.
I know I can get a witness. A lot of us in the midst of us sinking in life realize if it had not been for God.
Glory to God.
Come on. We'd have been lost our mind. We'd have been had a nervous breakdown by now. We'd have been through the tile end, but yet in the midst of being broke and sick and struggling, we realize God still has kept his hand on us.
Amen.
See, I'm a person where, you know, it's not always got to be the big stuff. I'm the type, I thank God for the Fruit Loops.
Come on, the Fruit
you
Loops.
You know what I'm saying? I thank God for the running water and stuff like that. I may not have a house on a hill, but at least I got somewhere to lay my head. You know what I'm saying?
Yes.
And a lot of times we get so caught up in looking at the top of the mountain. I got this far to go. Sometimes it's good just to take a break.
Glory
and look back down the mountain to see how far you've already come. And that's a miracle in itself. You know what I'm saying? Praise God.
The Lord is up in this house.
Yes, sir.
In this studio, which has become his temple. Glory to God. This is amazing, man.
Yeah.
What has been your driving passion? What pushes you to keep going?
What pushes me to get up, man? I know it's going to sound kind of funny, but it's for people to get up.
Mm.
I've always been the one rooting for the underdog.
Wow.
Yeah.
And it bothered me just growing up in church where, you know, and I'm just speaking about my background, I've seen majority of people in church were poverty stricken, but they were faithful to their churches. They would stand at the bus stop in the suit on and got their kids and everything, and they had the bus just to get to church. And they would be at church all day long. You know what I'm saying? You would see the mothers in the kitchen cooking and things of that nature. And you would sit back, but you would see the prosperity of the wicked. And it's like, come on, now something's wrong with this picture. There's something wrong when you see this church bus and it's the same people on this bus, you know, 8, 9, 10 years. You know what I'm saying? Wow. When we gonna get up? You know what I'm saying? When we gonna move up like the Jeffersons, but as believers?
Come on.
You know, and my driving force is just, of course, it's God pushing me, you know, for lives to be changed for the better.
Yeah.
You know, I hate to be, you know, as they say, the story of the Good Samaritan, how everybody else walked past my man.
Yeah.
You know, who gonna take the time to help him up? Mm. Not just give him a fish, but let me teach him how to fish.
How to fish.
You know what I'm saying?
Yes.
So that's my driving force, man.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, is when you see people with potential. That's something that's powerful, is that word potential.
Yeah.
Potential is not about what you've done.
Come on.
But about what ability you have.
The ability that you have.
It's an untapped resource that has got to be used. See, when the NBA draft players, they draft them based on their potential.
Amen.
And God picked us not because of our past.
Huh? Hmm.
He picked us because of our potential.
Glory.
He saw something in us that probably your mama didn't see, your daddy didn't see, your family members didn't see, but God said, that's the one right there.
Yes.
He said, matter of fact, in his word, he said, I've chosen the foolish thing. That means we are some ex-fools.
Come on.
Yes,
sir. Yes,
you know what I'm saying? If you don't believe you was an ex-fool, go look at some of your old pictures when you thought you were sweet.
Oh,
you know what I'm saying? With your silk shirt on and the snake skin belts and things of that nature. And God said, that one right there, that's the one I'm going to use. That's the one. You know, so regardless of what your situation was, I mean, look at the Bible. The majority of the Bible was written by murderers.
Yeah, it was.
Moses.
Yes, it was.
David.
Come on.
And Paul.
And
so if God can take this. Yeah,
that's
exactly.
My favorite.
There it is.
There it is. Goody too.
He didn't do it. He didn't do it.
No.
Yeah.
He want them folks that's been in the grind,
yeah,
you know, in the dirt, that's been there.
Yes.
And he said, I'm choosing a foolish thing. Watch this. To confound the wise.
Confound the wise.
You know, Moses made a statement and said, they won't believe me. They won't believe.
Who should I say
sent me? You know?
Yeah,
so you tell them, I am.
Yeah.
And then, you know, the simple fact that people was able to see the difference in Moses. And one of the things I tell the people at my church, don't be ashamed to go back to your old neighborhood when people say, I remember you when.
Yeah, yeah. Right.
Say to them, I'm glad you remember me when.
Yeah,
right.
Because you were eyewitness of how stupid I was
and
how jacked up my life was. And if God can do something for me,
glory,
if he can turn my life around and you know how messed up I was,
absolutely,
surely he can do something for you.
Yes.
So